Hey, everybody. Welcome to your Friday Nooner with me, Dave LaMont. Took Monday off because I had to go to the doctor. And that stinks, especially when the anesthesia doesn't work. So I'm back on Friday. And today is going to be an interesting program because we're going to talk about soccer here. I don't do that as often as I probably should. And I'm fascinated by this Super League story. And I think a lot of people are, and that's part of why I wanted a guest on who knows what he's talking about. Plus, he's a good guy. So I'm not going to waste any time. Let's bring him right away. One-time broadcast partner of mine, a senior writer for World Soccer, and a man who follows particularly overseas soccer with a great deal of passion, Kartik Krishnayier. How are you?
Great to be with you, Dave. Happy Friday. And I'm thankful you've recovered from that failed bout of anesthesia.
Yes. And I asked the doctor, I said, hey, did you wait long enough? Oh, it's fine. Wasn't fine.
That's doctor speak. It's fine, yeah. As doctor speak.
And I, you know, he learned the hard way. The owl caught him off guard. Then the second owl caught him off guard too. So, but all is well. I am fine. Let's start. I hate to use this cliche, but let's start from the beginning, because to me, what's interesting about the Super League is all the different branches this has taken since a few days ago. How big of a surprise was this announcement that these 12 so well-known clubs around the world were going to go off and do their own thing?
It was shocking. I don't think anyone expected it at that specific moment, partly because, Dave, this has been talked about. This is a concept that's been talked about for 20 or 25 years. And I think as I make analogies to compare it to American sports, it's generally going to be to college football, because that's the sport that's governed most similarly to soccer in Europe. It's like the college football playoff. For years and years and years, we never thought it would happen because there was one concoction or another of the Bowl Alliance, the BCS, right? However they could keep the bowl system going. This was similar. We've heard about a European Super League for about 20 years. There were pretty intense talks about it, 2007, 2008 or so. Then UEFA got a new television contract for their Champions League starting in 2009. And we keep hearing rumblings about it, but it's never actually come to fruition until this moment, where it came completely out of the blue at a time, I guess the pandemic being a trigger, but the need for kind of juiced finances for some of the top clubs who have spent themselves into debt and also have taken a hit from no fans in the stands for a year now.
I'm amazed that it did get by with such a surprise, because usually somebody leaks. Somebody, yes. You know, can't hold in a secret like this anymore. And I'm stunned that it was such a bomb without anybody knowing that this was coming. I wonder how. I can't believe they pulled that off with 12 different clubs in all these different countries, all these different self-interests, and yet they all shut up for a few minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. One of the pieces of analysis about that I've heard is that maybe they were concerned it was going to leak, which is why they rushed it out in such a haphazard manner. That's now Monday morning quarterbacking, right? After the whole thing has collapsed epically. But that's now a line of thought, that maybe they did actually have a more concrete plan. They did have a PR strategy, but because a leak was coming, they tried to preempt the leak by doing it in this rather, you know, embarrassing fashion, really.
Why these clubs in particular? Six from the Premier League and then three and the six others from European leagues. Why them?
So those are the richest clubs in Europe outside the three clubs that declined invitations reportedly, which were Paris Saint-Germain, the Paris club, the big Paris club in the French league, Borussia Dortmund and Bayern Munich, the two giant clubs in Germany.
Yeah.
And we'll get into Germany in a little bit, because there's a cultural and ownership model in Germany that's very different than the ownership models in the rest of the world, or at least in the rest of Europe. And the six clubs in the Premier League are the undisputed top six. They're the big six, as they've been called. At one time, they were called the Sky Six, because they got a disproportionate amount of television revenue and television appearances on Sky, which is the primary broadcast partner of the Premier League in the domestic market in the UK. And Sky is, of course, now owned by Comcast. At the time, they were owned by News Corp and Rupert Murdoch when the Sky Six moniker began. And now, as part of... And I'm sure all your viewers, Dave, are familiar with the Disney Fox merger and how that affected regional sports networks in the U.S. and some properties in the U.S. And ESPN having or Disney having to divest that stuff. Similarly, when they bought Fox's properties, they were forced by the regulatory commissions to divest from Sky, which had been a Fox property or partially owned by Fox, and has now been acquired by Comcast as a result. So that's why even when you watch the Premier League on
and NBC,
you see the synergies. So those six clubs obviously are the leading English clubs. The three Spanish clubs are the richest clubs in that country. In Italy, it ended up becoming the three traditional top clubs. Juventus, which is owned by Fiat, Chrysler Fiat, is the richest club. But the two Milan clubs got in, it looked like more on history and on financial need. Roma, Napoli, some of the other big clubs from outside the north of Italy, who you would consider maybe at this point richer and more successful clubs perhaps than the Milan clubs of late, were not part of this.
So it blows up spectacularly. It was like watching those building demolitions that are controlled demolitions, you know, the company building, the whole thing just goes like this. I can't recall in any sport anywhere in my lifetime anything just dissolving, especially with the heavy hitters that you mentioned and all the money that's out there. So the easiest question, I guess, to ask is why did this fail before it ever started?
They had not vetted the proposal well. They had not come out with a PR strategy, which may have enticed some fans. And certainly there was always going to be backlash. And I think the owners that were involved were smart enough to know this. One of the owners we're very familiar with in South Florida, Dave, was John Henry, John W. Yep. Henry. And he, by all accounts, was one of the masterminds of this and has been running Liverpool Football Club for 11 years now, and they've been very successful the last three seasons. But as they've become more successful, their financial problems have worsened. And it's interesting, John W. Henry didn't look to the MLB model, which he's invested in, obviously, first with the Marlins and with the Red Sox, for a solution. The MLB model, I think, might have been more palatable if you had had luxury taxes and things like that, but you could still spend at the amount you want to spend. This Super League was more based on the NBA model than anything else. It was very much inspired by the way the NBA is structured. And so they, I think, did not roll this out properly in a way where they could have. One of the very basic things I think they could have done was talk about how UEFA and FIFA have misgoverned the game to this point, and how they were going to make efforts to help grassroots football, smaller clubs, help grow women's soccer, because I think that that's a big thing for social justice advocates, and talk a little bit about racism and say, hey, UEFA hasn't done enough to counter racism. We're going to do that. They may have gotten the fans and the media on their side, because I think one of the things I want to talk about with this story is fans are getting a lot of credit for fan power stopping this. I think television broadcast media had a lot to do with stopping it also. The equivalent shows that we have on ESPN over there on Sky and BT Sport, they were just savaging this. Even the presenters, who normally are neutral, were savaging it. Right. And I think that drove public opinion, really, more than anything.
Just to explain for those who don't know, a presenter is a play-by-play guy. That's just the
term for it. The host, right.
Or the host. Yeah, I did some world bowling, and I was the presenter. I thought, oh yeah, that's right. I was hired by people from England, and I had realized that's my title for that. So that's the one language change from play by play. The blowback was unbelievable, and you mentioned media. The thing that was interesting to me about it is the attention it got in the United States. This was the lead story on some websites, and it might have been you or someone else who pointed out on Twitter that on ESPN.com, the top three stories overarch over any other sport that ESPN.com covers, and we know which ones they are, were about this Super League and the reaction and the negative reaction when it happened. And it leads me to ask you a little bit about the popularity of quote-unquote foreign soccer in the United States. That caught me off guard. The reaction was so big here.
Yeah, I think it's kind of twofold. ESPN and CBS Sports HQ, all of the sports websites, it was the lead story ahead of American sporting issues. Now, think about this: we're out of the NFL season, right? Even though we're talking draft, we're talking other football stories. What I've noticed with soccer through the last 5 to 10 years in the U.S. is it can penetrate the sports media when football is not being played, right? During the NFL and college football season, forget about it. But it has some sort of ability to compete with basketball, baseball, and hockey. So in terms of the second part of this I was going to mention is the foreign soccer angle is the Italian league is covered by ESPN. The Spanish league is covered by BN Sport. They are not as popular. And actually, CBS Sports have just won the rights to Serie A, the Italian league, right? That's shifting to CBS beginning in August and will be featured primarily on CBS Sports Network and Paramount Plus. They might show a couple of matches on broadcast. Those leagues haven't really penetrated the American sports landscape. But the Premier League has. England has, largely due to the fact that NBC has blown it out of the water, right? I mean, they show at least one match a week on over-the-air NBC. NBC Sports Network, which is getting shut down, by the way, but has for effectively the last 5 to 7 years been dominated by two sports, right? Hockey, which they're losing, which I think is part of the reason they're shutting the channel down, and the Premier League. So the Premier League has, on average, the amount of viewers for a game in the U.S. that the NHL does, and more than MLS does, oftentimes more than college basketball does. So I think it was the English clubs that made it an American story. I think if the English clubs hadn't been involved and had been Spanish, Italian, and let's say they had gotten some teams from France, some teams from Germany, I don't think the American sports media would have paid attention. Plus, you had American owners. I mentioned John W. Henry. You also have the Glazer family, who just won the Super Bowl with the Tampa Bay Bucks, and then you have Stan Kroenke playing maybe a lesser role than the Glazers and John W. Henry in this, but Kroenke is a obviously invested in. I think he has a team in every sports league in the U.S.
I think you're right. I want to say that he was with the Rams.
Yes,
there's an NBA team. Yep, the Avs. Yeah. That's right.
He owns a team in MLS, the Denver team in MLS. He owns also. Does he own the Rockies or not? Maybe he's not in baseball.
I don't think he's in baseball, but I'm not 100% sure about that. But that's, as soon as you mentioned that name, that rang a bell with his imprint on American sports. So it was it the English teams backing out as quickly as they did the unrecoverable blow for this Super League?
Yes, absolutely. And I think what we had was a dynamic of different English teams on having varying degrees of commitment. So as I mentioned, John W. Henry was one of the architects of this. And I find it ironic, being a baseball owner, he looked at the NBA model as what he wanted to construct this based on. But Henry and Glazer were all in on this. Kroenke, even though he's an American owner, we mentioned all the teams he owns. He owns Arsenal, by the way, in the Premier League. He's a more conservative guy, right? And I think he's found a way financially to balance the books at Arsenal without getting into the debt and needing the loans that these other two owners have. It's also a lack of ambition. His team hasn't won much, whereas the Glazers team is Manchester United. I think everybody knows about them. And Liverpool has had a renaissance under John W. Henry as the owner. They had not won anything. They had not won the league in 30 years and had struggled in other cup competitions. The last 3 or 4 years, they've been brilliant. And that's been investment from Fenway Sports Group. They've redeveloped their stadium, just like they did with Fenway. Same thing.
Yeah.
The traditional ground, like the Fenway model, they felt like, hey, we don't want to leave Fenway Park and build another baseball stadium in Boston. There's no land there anyway. But they did the same thing in Liverpool. Rather than doing what a lot of English clubs have done, which is build these huge stadiums on the outskirts of town, they said, okay, they understood. And this is why I think people were really surprised by Henry's involvement in this from a supporter standpoint. Henry realized the soul of that club, Liverpool, that he had bought, which is a similar urban area, everything to Boston, right? There are a lot of similarities, which is why they targeted the club to buy in the first place. Henry and his partner, Tom Werner, thought, hey, this is very similar to the Red Sox. I mean, we can do the same thing with this club we've done with the Sox, which they have, in fact. So they redeveloped the ground right in the heart of the city. They've increased revenues based on that. But then the pandemic struck, and they they're in a period where they're really, really good. But also being really good entails extending the contracts of guys. And maybe they made some bad decisions, emotional decisions, that players who are 28 or 29, that maybe that's when you let them go. They've signed the long-term deals and now have a team that's aging, team that's entering their 30s on long-term deals that you can't restructure, right? And they make too much money to offload them. And the same thing is that happens in American sports. Yeah, yeah. So I think that was very much kind of the trigger on Henry. So you had those three American owners. You have guys by the name of Joe Louis and Daniel Levy, who were British, that owned Tottenham. But for those of us who live in the state of Florida, like you and me, Dave, Lake Nona, the commercial development outside of Orlando, was developed by Joe Louis, the Tottenham owner. Mm-hmm. Pier 66 here in Fort Lauderdale, they own. So they're very kind of connected, at least in the real estate world here in the U.S. and particularly in Florida. And then you had the two kind of Chelsea and Manchester City, which are exceptions to just about every rule. Chelsea is owned by a Russian oligarch, Roman Abramovich, very close friend of Vladimir Putin's, although their managing director is American, Bruce Buck. And then City Football Group owns Manchester City. They are largely fueled by money, state money from Abu Dhabi. And they also own a club here in the U.S., New York City FC, among other clubs that they own. They own Mumbai City FC in India and Yokohama City in Japan, et cetera. But those two clubs were seen as clubs that don't need the money. And they were the last clubs to jump on of the 12. Manchester City was the last club. And now, in the wake of the collapse of the Super League, Florentino Perez, who's the president of Real Madrid, and along with Henry and Glazer, really, and Agnelli, the president of Juventus in Italy, really the inspiration for this thing, are saying Manchester City never really had their foot. They had a toe in the water, as I think he described, and they were then infecting the other English clubs. And they were very quickly able to convince Chelsea and Stan Kroenke's Arsenal to get out. And then when those three got out, the other three English clubs just followed.
Just left hanging there. Yeah. So, all right, let's the two-part question then. Let's say this. What would have been good about having this league stay together?
So I think you would have had a higher level of competition within that league, where those clubs would have been able to pool TV money. They would have gotten a TV deal. Now, this was the TV element was going to be really interesting. And I was surprised. One of the things about them haphazardly doing this is that they had not announced a broadcast partner. Very surprising. You would think they would have had that in the bag. I think because of the backlash from the existing leagues and FIFA and UEFA, the typical broadcast partners, your Sky's in the UK, ESPN's in the US, the Comcast-owned companies here in the US, NBC, they would have been out. So my guess is they would have gone to Netflix or DAZN or Facebook or Apple. They would have gone somewhere there to get to sell the rights. Maybe it's a global package. Maybe they don't do what these European football leagues do, which is if you're the Premier League, you have a partner in the U.S., which is NBC, but you have a different partner. That doesn't mean the Comcast owned entity in some other country has the rights. So you do it piecemeal by country. But the assumption is there would have been massive television revenues. I mean, this would have been a huge deal in global sports finance and global sports television. They were guaranteed a certain amount of money per year. I'm not sure the amount, but I think it was a gaudy number from JP Morgan, who was financing this, and the JP Morgan end apparently was arranged by the Glazers and the Glazer family. And they're well off, and they had that contact to get JP Morgan behind this. So that would have been the advantage. Is there would have been increased revenues for these clubs. These clubs also would have imposed some sort of salary cap, similar to the NBA cap, not the hard cap of the NFL, not the luxury tax system, which I personally favor of baseball. It was something where you could go over the cap to re-sign your own players, but then there were all these fines and punishments involved. Also, it's worth noting for our viewers that in European culture, the NBA is much more mainstream than NFL or MLB. So the American owners, obviously, and some of them are NFL owners, as we mentioned, also, and NBA owners in Kroenke's case, they would be exposed to all of the sporting landscape in this country. But the ones that are not owned by Americans probably saw the NBA as the model, because that's the league they're familiar with. They're
European influence and, you know, some tremendous European players in the last 10 years, especially. All right. So what's the bad then? Had this gone through, what would have been the negative?
So this would have effectively cut off all the other teams in football, because one, it was going to be a closed league, and they were going to guarantee qualification for the tournament every year for these 12 teams. Or they wanted it to be 15, but as I said at the outset, three teams turned them down. They were only going to have five spots via qualification. And so right now, the way you view European football is like the NCAA basketball tournament. Okay, you have different leagues, just like you have different conferences in the U.S. And a certain number of teams qualify for European competition, for the Champions League from each league. It's a set number, but it's the better leagues. Mm-hmm. It's four, and then there's a tournament like the NIT. It's funny how similar it is. There's an NIT tournament, and now they're going to start like a CBI level tournament starting next year. But yeah, there are assigned slots per league. Yeah, that's going to be brutal. There are assigned slots per league, Dave, but those slots were going to go away with this, right? There were only going to be five slots total based on merit performance and a locked-in 15 teams. So it would have been like Duke, North Carolina, Kansas saying, hey, we don't want to risk not making the NCAA tournament. Like, Duke didn't make it this year, right? We don't want to take that risk. So we're gonna create our own super conference where we're still going to play ACC games or Big 12 games, but we're also going to play midweek in this other conference, which, by the way, is going to award a champion like it's the NCAA tournament, and we're going to make the NCAA tournament, because UEFA was still going to operate the Champions League, but we're going to make the NCAA tournament a second-tier event, which is what the Champions League would have become. It would have been become, instead of the top six teams in England, we're all going to be out of it. So it would be like team 7 through 10.
Yeah,
so
then it becomes a product.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So then it weakens the rest of that that ecosystem, and effectively, I mean, the thing, if you want to use a college sports analogy, to me, the closest one that I can think of offhand is when, remember when all the teams left Conference USA, Louisville, Marquette, I'm sure there was Cincinnati and the others, and went to the Big East or wherever they went, ACC, and Memphis was left in Conference USA.
Right, and then they got out, and then now they're in the American Conference.
Yeah, yeah.
There's been such stunning movement in the last 10 years in college sports. It's settled down. It may have another earthquake again like they did a few years ago. I remember that well.
Yeah, when Memphis was stuck those couple of years when Cal was still there, when Calipari was coaching them, it was like, okay, you know they're going to win every game in Conference USA. They're going to be a number one or number two seed in the NCAA tournament, but we don't know how good they are until they get to the tournament. It would have been the same thing for the English clubs left, like Leicester City. Who else would have been left? West Ham. Okay, Leicester City would probably have ripped through the Premier League with these teams maybe out of the league, or even if they stayed in the league, not really needing to win in the league. But then we don't know how they would have fared in the bigger picture, or if they even would have qualified because of that. So that's what the downside would have been. The other downside would have been obviously revenues. These are the largest commercial entities in European soccer. So their success with sponsorships, having them in your league leverages your ability to get a massive TV deal. If they're suddenly not in your league, or in the case of the six English clubs, they were going to stay in the league but be less committed to it, let's be honest, and this would have been a secondary priority, the domestic league, then you're in a position where the next TV deal for the Premier League might be halved from what it is now, or significantly less. And look, unfortunately, the reality, and we found this now during the pandemic, and this is the case with American sports leagues also, and we just saw the NFL deal, it's TV money now. That's it's unfortunate or fortunate, depending on your perspective. That's it. The fans, Ticket sales, all of that matters less than it ever has. I mean, we even see how the Falcons have cut concession prices because they're getting enough TV money from the NFL. They can sell Cokes for $2 now at Mercedes-Benz Stadium. They don't have to sell them for 10 bucks anymore.
Well, it's funny because the argument, and this goes back for many years, people would always say, well, I'm paying the salary of that quarterback. And I go, no, you're not.
No, you're not.
When you turn on your TV, you're watching the people who are paying that salary. You're paying for something, but you're not, you know, that hot dog and that soda or whatever you're drinking is not helping that fullback to block better or anything like that. I think people are grasping because the numbers for these pro sports deals, and look what the NBA got from ESPN a few years ago, in the billions, the NFL in the billions, and there was all this talk, oh, they're going to go streaming full-time. Not yet, because the networks are not letting go of that valuable property, and that's a great point. I hadn't thought of the watered-down aspect of it, because the other thing that I was fascinated by, at least, again, and I was hearing more about the English clubs, as you touched on, was some of the comments about how this was just destroy the root of the game and destroy the supporters of the game. And it was James Corden, the late night talk show host. I watched his little monologue that he talked about for 6 minutes about, and it was he had almost a romantic air about him as to how important the game is to everyone there. And everybody seems to have a club, whether they're great or not great. And that angle also, you talked about the fans. That was another part of it. I wonder, I guess these clubs must have heard that.
Yeah, so I think in England in particular, there's a very romantic notion about the game. Every community has a club. Every small town has a club. Big cities have multiple clubs. Obviously, there's some big cities here that Yankees, Mets, Dodgers, Angels, right? But generally, you only have one sports franchise in a town per league. In England, that's not the case. Even in this breakaway, you had Manchester City and Manchester United. You had two Manchester clubs in it. There is a very community-oriented feel in England where these clubs are like churches or schools or community institutions in the U.S. And again, I come back to the college sports analogy. It's like cities like Gainesville and Tallahassee and Tuscaloosa and Columbia, South Carolina having teams. They don't have teams in American pro sports, but they do in cities of those sizes, which are college towns in the U.S. and have College Station, Texas, places like that, have similar professional teams in England. Now, those professional teams aren't the ones who are going to be included in this breakaway. They were the ones in smaller markets that are generally less successful that right. were going to be left behind. They're second or third division clubs in most cases. There are a couple, like Burnley is one exception, a small town club in the top flight that got promoted a few years ago and has stayed in the first division in England. Similar size town to Green Bay. So there's one of those, but mostly those clubs are in the second, third, and fourth division. And once in a while, they'll get promoted to the second or first division, and it'll be the biggest thing in the history of that town. So that's the connection that I think these owners did not understand. Now, again, I'll go back to John W. Henry. Although, again, when all of this happened, and I said this surprised me about Henry because he seemed to be the one, a foreign owner, that got it, and his connection to Liverpool supporters. And Red Sox fans were like, yeah, you're right. It's Marlins fans who came back at me and said, well, wait a second. Aren't you forgetting what happened down here? And truthfully, yes, that was my fault, my omission, because I even went on one of those junkets with Henry to the luxury suites in at Joe Robbie Stadium, where he was trying to pitch all of us on a stadium in downtown. At the time, it was downtown Fort Lauderdale. Obviously,
yes,
downtown Miami.
Yeah,
that got killed.
Well, Wayne Huizenga wanted no part of that. And the funny thing was, he had his Blockbuster business in Fort Lauderdale, downtown. But yeah, you know what? I'm not sure the site that they were looking at was going to work out anyway, truthfully. But I digress.
Yeah, it was on Andrews, just a little north of Broward, so it wasn't exactly, it's kind of where the Brightline station is now, so 15 years later, maybe it would have been okay, because there was a train station there, but the point being that Henry didn't get the supporters either, and that was the one guy we thought did, so these owners are very distant. A lot of them are oligarchs, or they fly in every now and then again for a game, and they're not very very much in tune with what the supporters want. Now, the funny thing is, though, there were some American-owned teams that resisted this and spoke out against it. So Wes Edens, who owns the Milwaukee Bucks, also yeah. and has spent a lot of money recently on the Bucks. Also, speaking of Brightline, is an investor in Brightline. I'm not sure if you knew that.
I did.
Was one of the primary investors in Brightline. Edens owns Aston Villa, and they were left out of this. And they were a second division club when he bought the club. Actually bought the club from another American, Randy Lerner, who owns the Cleveland Browns. And Edens has spent an extraordinary amount of money the last 3 years to get them back into the first division, get them promoted again, and now safe in the first division in the Premier League. And he was against it because he had invested so much in the club to try and get them to compete with the Liverpools and the Man Uniteds and the Arsenals. And then suddenly those clubs were going to break away. And also, the American owners at Roma, AS Roma in Italy, spoke out against it and said they would not accept an invitation to it. So that was there were some American owners who there's been a tendency to say, oh, well, it's all the Americans who wanted this. Yeah, to an extent, but there were a few that weren't like that. And Edens, I think, can relate to it because he owns the Bucks, which are a small market team in the NBA, might even be the smallest or one of the smallest markets in the NBA. So I think he was able to relate to it and said, I don't want my club being part of this in England, and we're going to fight against this, rather than Henry, who owns a Boston team, Glazer, who owns the world champions in the NFL, and obviously,
yeah,
and Kroenke, who moved his team, right, from St. Louis to LA to get to the bigger market, get back to the bigger market.
Well, so is it possible this could be revived, or is this left enough of a crater in the minds of these guys that we'll never see this concept?
That's really a toss of the coin right now, Dave, because I think it's left a really bad taste in everyone's minds, and they know how the fans will react. At the same time, I think finances dictate for some of these clubs that they get into a place where they can control more of their TV revenue. So I guess I should backtrack here. One thing we haven't discussed is that there is a lot of TV revenue, a lot of media rights revenue that comes in to the UEFA Champions League, which is the competition ultimately they would be trying to kill right now. And what happens is a lot of that television revenue drifts down to teams from Eastern Europe and Turkey and the Balkans and places where the teams are less wealthy and less marketable on an international stage. So this is effectively, and it's kind of like, I mean, I guess, again, I keep coming back to college sports more than pro sports in the U.S. It's kind of like what the old CFA did. Remember that, Dave? Years and years ago in College Football Association.
Yeah.
Where the money, and you could argue also the BCS was a bit of a cartel, right? The money didn't drift down to the other conferences. So the way UEFA is constructed now, money goes to the Ukrainian league, to the Greek league, to the Romanian league. So these clubs, the money is there, and they know the broadcast rights money is there. There's an incredible amount of money, billions and billions thrown every rights cycle at televising this property. In the U.S., it's televised by CBS Sports, it's on Paramount Plus, and CBS has done, by the way, I mean, just as an aside, CBS has done a phenomenal job with that property. They've given the NFL Today feel to soccer, which I really like with their Champions League coverage. But that money that CBS is paying, about 30 or 40% of it stays with these top clubs. The other 60% goes. So the way this Super League apparently was going to be structured is 90% of it would have stayed with those clubs, and 10% of it would have been given to other efforts. So while from a public relations standpoint, it seems like a dead idea, financial necessity and the continuing desire for media partners to throw money at these properties, especially in the post-COVID era, I think we're looking honestly at maybe attendances and ticket sales being an even lesser component of sports marketing and sports sports finance. I think it could very well be revived, but for that reason. Now, they would do it differently next time, right? They would roll it out differently.
They'd have no choice. They have to learn from their mistakes. Now, last thing I want to bring up before I let you go and get on with your life, but there was one part of this that was utterly fascinating to me. The threat that these players, had they broken off, would be banned from all these competitions and the biggest of the biggest, the World Cup, Could they have actually been banned? Could that have happened?
Wow, that's and you know what? That threat, I think, had a lot to do with the haste at which clubs began to pull out, and the anger at which a lot of fans who probably didn't like the idea but may not have taken to the streets and taken to Twitter and done the things they did. It was precipitated a lot by that threat. So the question is, and this is where soccer is fundamentally different than American professional sports, but again, similar to college sports. Yeah. Think of FIFA as the NCAA. And the NCAA can ban players. I mean, we saw it with DeJuan Huell a couple of years ago with UM basketball, something I'm still personally very angry about.
It was badly handled. I know we're getting slightly off topic, but that was awful.
That was awful. And I think it's had a knock-on effect for Canes basketball the last few years. But that's a subject for another day, Dave. We can do a whole show on Canes basketball.
We should, really. When we get closer, we should.
Yeah. But FIFA is like the NCAA. So they could, in theory, say, hey, we govern the sport. We govern these competitions. Players who participate in this breakaway league are banned from our competitions, just like the NCAA does that with teams that are in conferences, but the conferences are governed by the NCAA. So in soccer, they're in leagues, but the leagues are governed by their domestic football association, who are then governed by by FIFA. So FIFA issued this threat. Now, I am sure there would have been numerous court challenges to it, and even maybe challenges that said, hey, FIFA, you're a cartel. You're a monopoly. There is no – you don't have the option of going to another football soccer governing association. Just like – I mean, I guess the NCAA always argues here in the U.S. that NAIA exists, but come on, really. It's the same sort of thing, right? You know, there's no one at a high level doing what the NCAA is doing. There's no one at a high level doing what FIFA is doing. So there would have been court challenges. It would have gotten really ugly, but – that would have been litigated in the courts over a number of years. Perhaps the World Cup, which is next year, would have happened while this is all being litigated, and those players would have been out of luck. And that, I think, got at least fans all up in arms, because suddenly, if you're an England fan and 80% of your top players are playing for these six clubs and they're out of the World Cup, well, then you may not even qualify for the World Cup right at that point. So I think that was a big deal, Dave, but the legality of it, we don't know. And again, I mean, I think these organizations are all similar, the IOC, FIFA, and the NCAA. And the legality of some of these things, and which is why I've actually I had a great conversation with our friend Mike DeCourcy, Sporting News college basketball writer, who's also a big Liverpool fan, right, big soccer fan. And I told him, look, I think the Bill Self lawsuit might have a lot of impact on what happens in global governance of soccer. And he agreed with me. He was like, yeah, the NCAA and FIFA are very similar organizations. And in fact, I wouldn't be surprised if they talk to one another, right, about how they govern things. So I'm not saying that I don't know Bill Self's lawsuit, right? And I know public opinion is Kansas and Bill Self have been kind of outlaw programs and an outlaw coach in some regards. Maybe
loaded with them, by the way.
Yeah, right, right. Exception? Right. Yeah.
He just got, allegedly caught.
Right.
No, I that's another topic about that whole 95-year investigation that yielded, I think, three arrests of assistant coaches. Although we are seeing Sean Miller. Everybody on the planet is waiting for Will Wade to get the axe, except Will Wade. But the interesting thing about what you're talking about is I wonder where the jurisdiction lay.
Yeah.
You know, you've got three countries, Spain, the UK, and Italy. Where do you go with this? I applaud them for the power move of all power moves. Okay, you do your thing, but guess what? You're not invited to mine. That's a power move.
That is a power move. And the government involvement was another thing I think FIFA generally has discouraged. And that would have been tested in courts. Does the UK government have the power to effectively – now, these teams play in the UK, these six teams, but most of them are – they're organized as PLCs or LLCs, do they actually have the power to then stop these clubs from moving to another league? Does the UK government have that power? Just like does, would the American government, I mean, I know we had the issue with Virginia and Virginia Tech and the ACC. I came back to that analogy also. Everything comes back to college sports. It seems like when Governor Mark Warner at the time of Virginia threatened the ACC, basically, and not threatened UVA. UVA is a public institution. Hey, Virginia, right. You have to push for Virginia Tech to get into the Big East at a time when into the ACC at a time when Virginia Tech was part of the Big East lawsuit against the ACC. Similarly, could the UK government have really stopped these six teams from moving to the Super League? They were certainly threatening all sorts of government action. Were they threats? Jurisdictionally, could they have done it? Yeah, people say, yes, they could have. We're not really sure. It's never been tested in court. It has never been tested at a macro level. Yeah, you've never heard of anything like this before.
I know there have been lawsuits when NFL teams have tried to move. The Raiders, of course, went through a billion lawsuits in their days, shuttling back between Oakland and Los Angeles, and even when they left Oakland for Las Vegas. But nothing quite at a national level where, say, the Supreme – well, I don't know if the Supreme Court got involved with the Raiders or not, but if, like, the White House issues an executive order that so-and-so can't do this. Something like that. That would have been fascinating, and you're right. I have not a clue of how much – and I also wonder how much of this, honestly, is just smoke blowing. And, again, they smell what was happening. They smell the outrage from their citizens and their fans, and maybe they just jumped in and went – we'll make a popular choice right here. We'll side with the people who are mad.
That is really key, because we're not sure the British government could have done any of this to prevent these six teams from doing anything. They were just going with kind of the populist outrage. Whereas it's very interesting to look at Spain and Italy. So the specific owners that were driving forces in those countries, Florentino Perez in Spain with Real Madrid, and Agnelli in Italy with Juventus. And as I said, they're owned by Chrysler Fiat. So they have obviously a corporate element to that too. Because of the political influence of that corporation in Italy and that owner in Spain, the Spanish and Italian governments were silent. And in fact, there's some thought that both those governments would have eventually rubber stamped it, because they think, hey, you know, it's more revenue coming into our country. It's more sponsorship coming into our country. It's more TV money coming into our country. I guess when we talk about this, we're really focused, again, because the British League, the Premier League, is very popular in the U.S., thanks to NBC, among other, and also cultural similarities, common language, etc. Yeah. The Spanish and Italian leagues, not so much, although let's see what CBS does with Serie A. I think they have an opportunity to make the Italian league more popular here. But the reaction was different in the three countries. This outrage we're talking about, this anger, government involvement, all of that, fan protests, that's an English story. In Italy and Spain, it was much more muted. I don't think fans liked it, but I think at the same time, the political influence of those clubs, in addition to just kind of the reality of corporate governance, made it so such that you just have to accept it in those countries.
It's an unbelievable story. I can't recall anything quite like it in sports anywhere in any part of the world. And Kartik, thank you so much for providing all that insight and a lot of things I never thought about. I learned quite a bit today. Thank you. It's great talking to you again, too. Thank you.
Yeah, great being with you, Dave. Let's do this again soon on another topic.
We have to. Your idea about Canes basketball, we could easily break into just as many minutes talking about what's happened there, which unfortunately is not for the good. And as an alum, I am mildly concerned. But anyway... thank you again. I want to remind everybody, I'll post this on my YouTube channel as well and on my two Facebook pages, so there'll be plenty of opportunities to rewatch his breakdown of the collapse of what might have been. Just imagine if the NFL's 12 biggest teams had decided, we're out of here. We'll see you later. It's pretty much how it felt in England there. Kartik Krishnayier, thank you so much. Appreciate it, man. That'll do it for today's Nooner. We'll get back at it again on Monday. I'm Dave Lamont. Thanks for watching.